But we got a big exciting place here, you know, at the, I was starting to say First Church of God in Federalsburg, Maryland. We're in the wrong church today. At Cherry Lake Community Church. It was an exciting Sunday last Sunday. We got to go to assisted living, and Brother Tony went with us. All those young ladies in there really liked you, by the way. I thought they were taking videos of music. My wife said, no, they take videos of you. So anyway, he made a big hit with the old folks there, and he's really great. We'd love to have him with us. And we just had a wonderful time, and it was well received. So we'll be going back there, it looks like every 2 weeks for Sunday afternoon service, which will be great. This Wednesday, we're going to the mission and pass out donuts and coffee again. That'll be a lot of fun. If you're interested in either of those ministries, please let Debbie Bright know. And they have at the mission, I want to mention also, they have a huge food pantry there. So if you know someone in need, you can direct them to go there and they will help them out. No need for anybody in Winter Haven to be hungry is our words. So, and I'm sure they're truthful to those words. Okay, so what do we have going on this week? Let's see. Okay, tonight, 6 to 8, we have the youth. I saw it on the slide. Wednesday, 7 to 8, we have youth and we have Bible study. Brother Clarence Ferris is doing a Bible study that's, I understand, really good. I actually went through it some years ago, and it was good, by Henry Blackaby. And if you want to take part in that, please come out. And if you're going to come and you haven't been, let him know and make sure he has materials ready for you. Okay, am I missing anything else? Anybody, anywhere? Okay, nobody's waving an arm, so let's all stand up and give praise. We're gonna do a couple of oldies here, and then some newies. Okay?
Tears of sympathy and pride, caring not the words we say it by. No, we not, it was for me he died on Calvary. Mercy there was great and grace was free. Pardon there was multiplied to me. There my burden soul found liberty at Calvary. By God's word at last my sin I learned. Then I trembled at the cross burned. Till my guilty soul in glory turned to Calvary. Mercy there was great and grace was free. Pardon there was multiplied to me. There my burden soul found liberty at Calvary. Now I give to Jesus everything. Now I gladly own him as my king. Now my raptured soul can only sing of Calvary. Pardon there was multiplied to me. There my burden so found liberty at Calvary. Oh, the love that drew salvation's plan. Oh, the grace that brought it down to man. Oh, the mighty thought that God did span at Calvary.
Sing it out.
Mercy there was great and grace was free. Pardon there was multiplied to me. There my burden soul found liberty at Calvary.
Let's see that again.
Oh, mercy there was great and grace was free. Pardon there was multiplied to me. There my burden soul found liberty at Calvary.
Amen. Calvary, got that. It's all right. You can give the Lord a hand of applause, Brian. You got to go ahead and give the Lord a hand of applause.
Great songs, great words, great words found in Scripture. It's a wonderful thing that when you can sing about what you know and you love, the Word of God is a good thing. So
thanks a lot more special. I mean, it does. Well, here's one we like to sing about. We all like this Mansion Over Hilltop thing, right?
I'm satisfied with just the cottage below.
that story of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego depending wholly on you, that their lives could be changed and they could be saved from this world that is bent on destruction. Father, we ask these things, that the givers would be blessed, that you would fill their hearts with a desire to tell others about you and do all the wonderful things that you have for us in this life while we're here. And just protect them from this world. Bless all. In Jesus' name we ask it. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. And I would be remiss if I did not say there is a basket in the back. We don't pass the basket now because of the C word. I haven't even used the word, right? And you can give online, I understand, too. There's some button you can click, and there you go. Okay, we have a song here for you. This is a Matt Redman song. And Matt was in a big church, and it got to be all about music. It got to be all about a lot of things. And the Lord spoke to his heart, the pastor's heart, and said, you know what? We're just going to stop music for a while. We're not going to have music. We're just going to maybe sing. We're not going to have musicians. We're not going to have a big fancy thing like you and I, brother. You know, nothing like that. And that's what they did for a while. And Matt went back, and he just thought, and the Lord spoke to him, and he penned this down for himself, not really intending it to be a song, but it was a very popular song called The Heart of Worship.
When the music fades, all is stripped away, and I simply come.
So, Kathy asked me to do this morning's prayer, and I was thinking tend to think that the world is greater than God. That there's so much going on that we think that, where is God? You know, COVID, just so much hate, everything that's going on, it's hard to sometimes not think that way. But we have to do a better job ourselves. And I came across, or not came across, but the Lord brought me to Psalms 90, where it says, where Moses prayed, and a prayer of Moses, the man of God, Lord, you have been our dwelling place throughout all generations. Before the mountains were born, or you brought forth the whole world, for everlasting to everlasting, you are God. So I think that really says it all. Before the mountains, before everything, God is here. So he knows, he's here with us, and he's going to get us through everything. So all we have to do is have faith, right? And believe that he's there for us, right? So with that said, bow your heads. Lord, we just love you and we praise you. We're so thankful that we're here together today to hear your word, to share it with our friends and church family and with our friends, and that we can take this out today and always and share it with all of those out there that don't know you, Lord, that are struggling, that don't know the path that they need to be on. So, Lord, give us that strength to be your light outside of these walls. And always, Lord, we ask that you be with our world today, with our leaders, with all of those that are trying to share your word way away from here where they're being persecuted. Lord, be with them. Give them courage, give them strength. Give us courage. We're not persecuted, but sometimes we act like we are. So Lord, give us the strength. Give us the ability to not worry, that we know where we need to be and where you are. So Lord, we ask these requests to you, all of those that need your touch for help or family problems, Lord, that you would love them and that you would show them that they're not alone. Lord, we ask that you be with Tony today as he brings us your word, and that you would open our hearts and our minds to receiving them. Open our ears to hear. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. A great service already. Wonderful time of fellowship. Wonderful seeing people from last week, seeing some new faces. And if you haven't got to meet me yet, it's good to be here. I've met a few people this morning even. And so it's good to be here to share with you for these few weeks. And I want to share with you from Hebrews chapter 10, verses 19 through 25. That's going to be our main text, but I want us to talk about that just a moment, because I think it's important to kind of give in context of why this was written and who wrote that. Most likely, I'm not a scholar, but scholars think, and they kind of agree, which would leave me out of that, but I can go along with them on it, is that this book was most likely written by Apollos, possibly. They think maybe Barnabas could have done it. Maybe even Apostle Paul changed his style a little bit, perhaps. But all of these were contemporaries, and they were writing for a really important reason. They were writing to the church, and Hebrews, the Jewish Hebrew converts, the new Christians that came into the faith, they were having a little bit of a problem wanting to go back to the old style of living, to go back to the law and to go back to the old way. Because, you know, really, and we see this in our own lives today, I think we're tempted today to do the same thing. When we become, it's easy to want to just go back to what was familiar. And it's much more difficult to build a relationship than it is to have a religious checklist. And see, that's what they were doing. Under the law, it was just a checklist. And we know, we read in the Pharisees, as people will do, they'll take something bad, and you know what we'll do? We'll make it worse. So there was the law. God gave the law for a good reason. We couldn't kind of hang on to it and keep close to him with it. And we just added things to it. And according to the records of many scholars and things, that there were some 600 and something regulations that the Pharisees had turned. It's never a good thing. Let's just say that, whether it's in the church or in the world. And so this is where they're wanting to go back. They're wanting to go back to doing a checklist instead of putting the hard work into building relationships. I don't know if you know this or not, but it's tough to get along with people. I don't know. It's so much easier to just check a box, because people aggravate you and you aggravate others. And so we just have these things called personalities that rub each other sometimes. And it's just more difficult to build a relationship than it is to complete a checklist. And they were kind of tempted to go back because it was a hard thing getting into this new faith and building those types of relationships with each other. And so this book was written to kind of address that and other things. And the writer details in the first part of chapter 10, and I encourage you to go back and read that later. But he details in this first part of chapter 10 that Jesus is now the ultimate high priest. If you get this setting, that he's saying, look, now Jesus is the ultimate high priest now in this new and living way. And Jesus is not just a priest that will take a sacrifice for you on your behalf. He actually became the sacrifice. And there's a big difference than taking a sacrifice and becoming it. And he detailed this in a great way. And he reminded people that, you know, before, you want to go back, but before you go back, he's kind of saying, now before you do that, kind of like kids. Now, you need to think about this before you make this decision. excuse me. He said, here's the thing to remember. You were just temporarily covered. Your sins were just temporarily covered before. And you had to do it over and over again. But now, through Christ, your sins can be permanently forgiven. Now, this is a much better thing. And he's saying, he's detailing that whole idea of this wonderful thing that Jesus has done for us. And with our sins, and what it means for us. And so with our sins now being removed and not just covered, we could actually be in the presence of God. We could never be in the presence of God before Christ, because that was the priest's job, and he could only do it just very rarely could he go into the most holy place of holies. And so now we become the temple, and God is there, and we have access to him all the time. And no longer, he reminded them, do we have this earthly person that we have to go through that we call a priest. No longer is that the case, that they have to appeal to God on our behalf. Now we can go straight to him, he said. And he details all those things, the wonderful things about the gospel. No longer, he said, do you have to wait to have your sins cleansed and forgiven. Immediately, when you realize that you've transgressed against God, now you can go straight to God through Jesus Christ, the new high priest. What a great thing. In this new and living way that the gospel detailed, the writer says, because of this, and he begins in verse 19. He begins in verse 19. He says, therefore, it's always good to look what something's there for when you see therefore. And go back and look and see why they put therefore there. And so, and he said, therefore, because of this, because of what Jesus has done in this new way, we have access to God now, and he became our sacrifice, and therefore, because of that wonderful thing that he's done, he's connected man and God back together as it was in the beginning. The Lord always wanted, God always wanted that relationship. We broke it, and now that Jesus has come and he's connected it back, therefore, and he gives us some things to look forward to and to look into. And because of what Christ had done, he gives us some admonishing commands, if you will, of encouragement. We're going to look at those this morning. That's really what I want us to do. But I thought, hey, I want to do this in a little bit different way. Maybe we can do this in a little different way.
You know, they say that good digestive health and good overall health for your body is something that they know that now we have to have a good source of vegetables. Okay? We have to have a good source of vegetables. And I know he said, hey, eat your vegetables, Mom always said, right? And now we're finding out through science that hey, there really is a lot to that. We've got to have a lot of vegetables and leafy greens. And I don't know if you know this yet. I'm going to tell you some news you don't know. But here it is. The Bucks won the Super Bowl. Anybody heard of this? Yeah. The Bucks won the Super Bowl. And the quarterback, as you know, Tom Brady, is known and has been known for his healthy lifestyle of eating, you know, and his healthy, his remaining healthy. And one of the things that I did not know until I started preparing for this message, because I was thinking about things and I looked and did a little research, and, you know, he started this thing in 2013, actually, started talking about it, but 2013, launched this TB12, Tom Brady 12, I guess. I didn't look at it enough, but I'm assuming that that's what it is. And it's this nutritional plan. And it's all these kind of things, and, you know, they're all kind of nutritional plans out there. But what struck me was, when I was preparing for this and I saw some headings and things, is that overall, he says is you need an 80-20 balance between vegetables and lean protein meats. So 80-20, more vegetables than you do on the meat. And I like that because, you know, you see some of these places and some of these diets says no meat, all plant-based. And I'm thinking, there's no way I'm going to do that. I've come too far to turn back now. I'm not going to do it. But I can cut back. I just can't do that, right? So I thought, well, that was kind of neat. So I read into it some more. And between that 80 and 20, you know, he's got all these lists of what are the better vegetables and what are the not so good, and the same thing with the proteins. And so he has a great plan, and apparently it's working from him. And one of the big takeaways from it is that most vegetables are really pretty good for you. If it won't kill you, it'll be good for you, right? It's good. So if you eat it and it doesn't kill you, it's pretty good. It's going to be good for you some, and some are better than others. And so one of the things that was a takeaway from that, as I looked at that, and lettuce is considered, you know, a vegetable. And you think of lettuce as not having a lot of nutritional value, but in looking into this, lettuce actually has a good bit of nutritional value. Some lettuce has more than others. One of the nutritional values is one that's an obvious, is that it's a filler for a lot of foods, and it keeps you from eating more, right? So that's a good thing. So not only that, but there's a lot of different nutritional values, and different lettuces have different nutritional values, and some are very high in some things that we need. So a great salad, a great healthy salad, has a variety of lettuce. You ever notice that? You go out, if you get a salad, it's not just one lettuce, right? There's several of those lettuce, and it makes it good, and it's healthy. And you add some protein to it, man, you can just have a good meal. Who would have ever, as they say in Alabama, who would have ever thunk it, right? I mean, you could just eat a salad and have a meal. I didn't know that. As long as you put some good lean protein meat and chicken on there, right? So, in knowing that, I was thinking about that, and I was having some fun with that in my research, and I was thinking, what I needed to do better eating myself, you know, and all these things coming together, and I thought, well, hey, maybe we could have some fun this morning, and let's try to together look at this scripture and somewhat prepare a similar spiritual salad, okay? So, if you're with me here, we're kind of going to run on the track of we know about all the food stuff, and we know about lettuce, we know what a salad is, and then we know some spiritual things, but let's look at these kind of together and see if we can relate to them this morning, have some fun with this. And I believe that God would speak to us as we look into his word, because remember, a mixture of lettuce is a good thing on your salad. It's the base of your salad. You throw all that other stuff in there, it makes it good and healthy, and you add that to it. Well, in the same way this morning, I want us to look at a great mix of lettuces. We're going to look at a great mix of lettuce, okay, together. And we're going to ask God to put some other good stuff in our lives along with the base of the lettuce that we look at. You're going to see what I'm talking about here, okay? So if we ask God, he said that he would answer, didn't he? He would give it. And this is what makes the living word of God living, is that we read this and we ask God, help, show me what I need. And I can say, he's going to say, Tony, in relation to that, here's some things I need you to add, or here's some things I need you to take out of your life this week, today. Ed, you heard the same thing Tony heard, but here's something I need you to do. And here's something I need you to do. And here's something, and so if we ask God, he's going to kind of say, well, you know, I think I need to do that. I need to add that, or I need to take that away to be more healthy.
started eating a little better when we got married, right? That's when you first start, guys, when you start. And Pat, it sounds like that does no good to eat a salad if you're going to put a half a bottle of dressing on it. Oh, okay. So I had to take some of that out and, learn to mix that up a little bit more. So what I want to look at this morning is this scripture, and we're going to look into this together, and it's going to be Hebrews chapter 10, verses 19 through 25. And so if you're following along at home, you want to read that. I'm reading out of the NIV, and so we're going to read verse 19, and here is the writer of Hebrews encouraging the church. Therefore, because of what Jesus did, brothers, since we have confidence to enter the most holy place by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way, open for us through the curtain that is his body. And since we have a great priest over the house of God, Jesus himself, verse 22, let us draw near to God with a sincere heart, in full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled to cleanse us from a guilty conscience. And having our bodies washed with pure water, let us hold unswervingly to the hope we profess. For he who promised is faithful. And let us consider how we must spur one another on toward love and good deeds. Let us not give up meeting together, as some are in the habit of doing, but let us encourage one another. And all the more as you see that day approaching. So here it is. The writer is saying, because of what Jesus has done, he said, first off in verse 22, here's the first lettuce I want us to put on here. He said, first in verse 22, let us draw near to God. Man, that's a good piece of lettuce right there. If we could just get that in our lives, if we could just understand it, that's a healthy thing. If we could just get a big head of that, draw near to God, and pull some off every day, it would be a great, healthy, spiritual life that we're living. Let us draw near to God, he said, because of what Jesus has done. We can now draw near to God with a sincere heart in full assurance of faith. Now, why? That should mean something to us, but it does not mean near what it would have meant to a Hebrew Christian convert. Think about that. They didn't have a sincere heart when they went and offered their sacrifice for their sin. I mean, it was as sincere as they could be. Not being judgmental, but how can you be sincere when you know on your calendar you got to come back with another sacrifice regardless of if you've done good, bad, or indifferent? There were certain times and certain things in this religious order that you had to present certain sacrifices at certain times of the year. And so here you are, I'm coming to the priest and I'm saying, I want to cleanse myself of sin and here's my offering and I don't want to have, I want to be close to God, and knowing in the back of your mind that you got to come back. You have no choice. You're hopeless with that. You're going to have to come back with another sacrifice. How can you be real sincere? How can you have a full assurance of faith that God is going to forgive you when you know you got to come back later? You see, it was the best that they had, but it sure was not what we have now. And the writer wanted the people to know, the church to know, don't go back to that. Look what Jesus has done. Now you can come before Almighty God with full assurance of faith right before him yourself. In fact, this was something that was preached. This was something that was taught. This was something that many people missed at that time. The wonderful opportunity to have that access to God. No more did you have the sacrifice of an animal to cover your sins. And now we're told that we can come before God with a clean conscience. We can come before him just like, and he gives this example. He says, having your bodies being washed with pure water. We can do that. He said, so now, since we can, let's draw near to God. You could never do that before, but now you can do it, so let's draw near to him. This would have meant so much more to that person during that time frame, especially with the words that you see, pure water. We have water here. You may think, well, my water in my house, I'm going to have a filter. It's not that good. Trust me, anything that you have, running water in the United States of America is better than most anywhere else in the world today, let alone that time. We've got good water.
This was something, the pure water was something that was a rarity. So you think about these words that he's using and it, how it's maybe putting a picture in these people's mind that, well, I can go now and have confidence before Almighty God. I don't have to be afraid of it. It's like if I just had a bath of pure water, I didn't even have a drink of pure water. What must that have picture that would have put in their minds if you think about that? I don't know if you realize this. We went on a cruise one time, a long time ago, right? They don't have any cruises now. Oh, bring back the cruises, right? But, you know, you can get some really expensive water. And there was one water, I don't know, I'm not big on that water. If it's good, it's good. But Voss water, you ever seen that? VOS. Very expensive. Oh, they'll have it for you in some of these fancy hotels, and they'll just have it right there for you. And they'll add it right to your bill. And it'll be high. You know, $15, $20 for a bottle of water. Crazy Voss. You know, if you're in with it and I'm not, you know what that's about. But I have read about it. And the thing is, it'd be like someone who's in the know, who's whatever they're in now, would say, hey, you're just going to take a bath of Voss water. It's just a wonderful thing. That now that we have this opportunity, he said, let us draw near to God. You can be clean, he said. You can be a person that God is not going to be repulsed by because your sins are washed away now. So, he said, let us draw near to God because we can. And the reason we can is because of what Jesus, your high priest, has done. Oh, it was a great thing. But he didn't stop there. Verse 23, he says, let us hold unswervingly. Man, let us do that. Let's read that verse, verse 23. Let us hold unswervingly to the hope we profess, for he who promised is faithful. Oh, let us hold on to the hope. Now, that's a good piece of lettuce right there. I mean, I think we need to add that. I feel bad for people who don't have that in their life, salad, hope. You know, it has been said before, and I believe it. In a certain number of days, and I'm not going to quote it, it's not my message, but I just remember this is thinking, there's a scientific number of days that you can live without water. There's a scientific number of days that you can live without food. But it's really hard to live one day without hope. You think about it. You think about what it would be. Oh yeah, you'll live and you'll exist, but without hope you don't live. You see, when you're starving for water and you don't have it, or food and don't have it, you have the hope that you're going to get it. And that keeps you going. If you have no hope, life ceases to exist. You just exist. And so, here we have this great hope in Christ, and the writer here says, let's not forget that. Let's not overlook that. Let's draw near to God, yes, but let us also hold unswervingly to the hope that we have. We have a great hope, he said. This is a wonderful promise that God has given us because of what Jesus did for us voluntarily in the physical. We now have an eternal spiritual hope. Think about that. Did you know what you do, what I do physically, what you say, what I say, has an eternal value to it? It has a worth to it, how we can encourage. Jane talks about that, doesn't he? He said you can either curse or you can bless with what God's given you. And everything has an eternal value. Because we don't know when our eternity is going to begin. And we're going to talk about that in a little bit, because the church during this period was the same way. They wasn't sure of that. But Jesus conquered all these terrible things that he had to go through physically. You know, most of us don't know what it's like. You may have experienced some hardships in life, but to not have a home, you know, Jesus was homeless. To not have a regular routine, he didn't have a routine. He just went on the will of the Father, and he went and shared this wonderful news. He didn't have a guarantee of a meal. He didn't know, okay, after I get through preaching, it's going to be lunchtime. We're going to run up to wherever you're going to run up to, or back to your house at your kitchens and what have you. He didn't have if you think about it, he overcome a lot of things. But more than that, Jesus, Scripture said, overcame death, hell, and the grave. He did this and gave us this wonderful hope. And see, the great thing about as a new Christian at that time, in the same way it should be here, is that now we're able to follow with him to See, Scripture says if you are participate in his suffering, you also participate in the good things that Jesus has provided. And he has provided us a way when we leave this world to eternity, to God, a place called heaven. And so we have a hope. But and the reason we know we can go there is because he's already been there. He has conquered those things, and now we have the hope that in Christ we follow him there. It's a wonderful hope. It's a wonderful hope. There's the old hymn, Hope, says that we have a hope within our souls brighter than the perfect day. God has given us his spirit, and we want the world to hear it. All the doubts are passed away. Now, do we have proof of things? No. It's a life of faith. But do I have doubts? Absolutely not. No doubts, no proof, just faith. See, faith bridges the gap between doubts and proof. The world wants to have the proof of things, but you can't get everything proved. You have to have faith. The problem is with the world, and I won't go all the messes, but this could be one if I wanted to be. The problem with the world is when you do prove it, they change the definition. You know, you can prove that life begins well before that kid pops out. But you know what? We want to change that definition. We don't want to follow the science on some things, but we want to follow on others. You see, here's the thing. Christ has given us a wonderful hope. And the writer of Hebrews wanted to remind these people that now, through Christ, we don't have to rely on anyone but the Lord Jesus Christ. He is the way, the truth, and the life, and we have a wonderful hope in him. And the Apostle Paul talked about that hope, and he wrote to the church in 1 Thessalonians 4:13. And he talked about that same hope. And if you think about the time frames, you look back on all these the writings, it was just roughly a 20-year different period of time when these two were written. And Paul talked to the church. Let me just go there. We could go there. 1 Thessalonians 4:13. Listen what Paul says about this. 4:13. Brothers, we do not want you to be ignorant about those who fall asleep or to grieve like the rest of men who have no hope. Because that's a bad place to be. We believe that Jesus died and rose again, and so we believe that God will bring with Jesus those who fall asleep in him. Notice the words. We're going to talk about that. According to the Lord's own word, we tell you that we who are still alive, we who are left till the coming of the Lord, will certainly not precede those who fall asleep. Verse 16. For the Lord himself will come down from heaven with a loud command, with the voice of an archangel, with the trumpet call of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. After that, we who are still alive and left will be caught up to with him in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so we will be with the Lord forever. Therefore, encourage one another with these words. You see, Paul wrote the same thing as the writer of Hebrews here is writing. Says we have this great hope beyond the grave. And this hope that only comes through Christ and him alone. That this hope that we have. You see what was going on back then. Not the same now, but similar. You see, people believe the gospel message. They come into the church and they were converted from this old way of life. And so they come in, they were being tempted to go back. And yet they believed this, that this was the truth and this was the Messiah. And so they believed that he would come back. And they were thinking he was going to come back, you know, within their lifetime. So what started happening in the church is they started talking like, man, I hate that daddy's going to miss Jesus, he done passed away. Oh, my brother got killed in that tragic donkey accident. Now he won't make the coming of the Lord. And so they were thinking that when people died, they wouldn't experience this wonderful thing when Jesus come back. And Paul said, that's not true. Death, the way you describe it, is not what God described. God doesn't know what death is because he's the source of life. Time, the way you think of it, is not the way God thinks, because there's no time with God because he's an eternal God. And he used those words of falling asleep. And if you go back and look at that. So Paul was saying, don't worry, you have a hope. And there's hope for those who have passed away already before you that have known the Lord Jesus. So there's hope for everyone. Plenty of hope to to go around. It was a great message of hope. And the writer says, let us hold on to the hope. Hope is a great thing, but he didn't stop there. Let's look at verse 24. Verse 24, he says, and let us consider how we may spur one another on toward love and good deeds. Oh, let us consider how we can put others first. Now, that's a rare piece of lettuce to get in people's salads. Man, that's some romaine stuff right there, the good purple peel kind. It's hard to find that in a lot of Christian folks' salad. Let us consider how we can spur one another on to love and good deeds, because we want to be spurred. We don't want to spur. We want to be spurred. We want people to love us and do good works to us. Because you know why? That's what our old way. Now think about this. Now think about this. Christians then won't go back to their old way. We're Christians. I don't doubt that most of you here in this sanctuary is a believer in the Lord Jesus. I hope you are. If you're not, I pray that God's conviction would lead you there, because you can't be saved just because you want to. You've got to be drawn by the Holy Spirit, according to the Word. You can't just say a magic prayer and there you are. But I believe that probably most of us are. But you know, we still are tempted to go back to our old way, just like we were. You know, if you've been married, doesn't matter if you've been married for 2 or 20-something years, there's times when you're going to get reminded to pick something off the floor. I'm just saying, not that I've had it. I'm not saying that that happens to me. I'm just saying I've heard that you're going to get reminded to pick some clothes up or do something. I'm just saying. That happens. We always want to drift backwards. You have to work hard. You don't have to do anything to drift back. You got to work hard to go forward, see? And so what happened here is he said, let us consider how we can spur one another on toward love and good deeds. Man, I said, it's. I find myself, and I may be in an audience of one, two plus God, but I find myself drifting back to think about self more than what I need to at times. I mean, I do. I have to just admit it. I think sometimes more about myself, my needs, my wants, my situation, my circumstance, me, my me. There was a good country song written about that. Look it up, Toby Keith. We just want to think about me, oh my, number one. Unless, and I have that problem, unless I'm helping someone else. You know, I found this out. It's a crazy thing. I found out the more, if I'm helping someone else do something, I'm not worried about what I've got to do. If I'm helping someone get through a hard time that they're going through, I'm not really thinking about the hard time I'm going through. If I'm helping someone else do something, I'm not thinking about myself. It's amazing how God has wired us in such a way. When we care for others above ourselves, Paul told the church, Philippians 2:3, he said, consider yourself less than others. And he said it like this, consider others more important than yourself. And here's the wonderful thing about the church, God's church, is if we all do that, while I'm considering this person more than me, and I've got needs and I don't know how I'm going to meet them, someone, God sends somebody to say, hey, I'm going to help Tony out. And I couldn't have done it by myself. And I didn't know who could help me, but that person considered more. I can't tell you how many times I've come across things in my life that I just didn't know how I was going to do it. And God always comes through. And most of the time, it's through a person, through flesh and blood, whether they know it or not. If we consider others, let us consider how we can spur each other on to love and to good deeds. You know, I believe that, science does, it is catching up. We're making wonderful things, you know, all kinds of progress and things. And eventually, I don't think we'll ever catch up to the Bible, but it's making some good grounds in the time frame that we're living now. And we're seeing that when a person is focused on themselves, when a person is laser focused on themselves, it heightens anxiety, it heightens depression, it heightens hypertension, blood pressure. Oh my goodness, all my problems. You can get worked up in a hurry. As they say, as the old preacher said, you can get lathered up quick when you think about yourself. Right? You can get all lathered up. We don't even know what lathering is. These kids don't even have to know what a bar of soap is. It's all in a squirt bottle with a superhero on it, right? It's like it's in the shape of a superhero and just squirt it out. We don't even know what a lather is. But you can get lathered up real quick when you think about yourself. Because what happens is, when we focus on ourselves, then we venture out in comparing ourselves to someone else. And when you do that, there's never a good thing. You're always better off than some, but you never look in that direction. You look in the other direction. You look at those who are better off than you. And sometimes that produces a lot of mental anxiety. Life is kind of like a number line, and when we focus on ourselves, we always look in the negative direction. We don't look in the positive. And that negative direction, as a math teacher, it goes on forever, and so does the positive. It just depends on which way you look. That's why I tell kids that have problems with math. I said, math's easy. You only go in one of two directions. You're going to go positive or negative. Let's figure out what we're doing here, okay? It can't be that hard. You're going to go one or two, left or right. You're not going up and down. The writer here reminds us of that wonderful thing, that we need to focus on other people. And he says, if you want a real spiritual, healthy life, then you need to consider others to spur them on to love and good works. But he didn't stop there. We're almost finished. He said this in verse 25. He says, let us not give up meeting together, some in the habit of doing. Well, that's a good one. That's a good piece of that. I'm so glad y'all threw that in the salad. I'm looking at some wonderful faces this morning. You just come right on to church with yourself this morning. That's a wonderful thing. It's important to meet together. The Greek word translated of give up, like do not give up your meeting together, the Greek word, and I'm not trying to pronounce it, you can go look it up, but it means to abandon or forsake it. Abandon. Giving up together, and the writer says that for several reasons, some good reasons. Obviously, one of the reasons, you remember, people were thinking about abandoning this new faith and going back to just the old religious checkmarks. And let us not do that. Don't abandon your faith. But also, just like today, that there's some issues that we have from time to time that we may get discouraged and abandon the faith figuratively. You see, remember, Jesus came to build a relationship. He didn't come to establish a religion. And you can't build a relationship unless you don't spend time with people. And so you got to have time. And so the writer of Hebrews knew this, that you had to gather together to spend time, to encourage one another and to get to know each other. And he said he knew this, and that's going to help build a relationship with others. And that's what God wants us to do, because he wants us to have a relationship with him. He sent Jesus for that. Now, that's the ultimate goal. Now, how's someone else going to know about that relationship if we don't build a relationship this way? See, that's the whole purpose of the church. So it gets down to something simple. Doesn't mean it's easy, but it's simple. He said, let us not forsake the assembling of ourselves together as some are in the habit of doing. Some have turned away and walked back. Let us not abandon that, he said. We need to meet physically together. Encourage one another. Now, you know, COVID-19, this pandemic, it's really put a damper on the meetings, the church, and that's okay. And I want you to listen to me. I want you to hear if you're there at home or if you listen to it live or if you do, it's okay. The church has always had to adjust. Now, I want you to think about words. Words are important. A very wise man in my congregation back years always said, now, words are important. Use them correctly. So I want you to think about the words this morning. It's okay to adjust your meeting together. Hey, the church has done that for years. If you're sick, you stay home. You break your leg, you can't get up the steps, you're going to stay home. You have a problem, you're going to stay home. If you know you got company coming into town, you're at church when you can most of the time, but this is an opportunity. They're not saved, and you know they're not going to go with you, so you just stay home with them, and you love on them. Do that. You need to. There's no religious check mark that you're going to be closer to God whether you come into a building or not. That's not the purpose. But if you can, see, Scripture says you ought to meet together. Adjusting is okay. But abandoning is altogether different. See, only God knows. It's a great thing that I'm not having to be the judge.
say this, that I want to say it emphatically, adjusting is okay. And during this pandemic, a lot of people adjusted and not come back, and that's okay. That's some really good reasons. But I want to say this, and I want you to consider something with me, and I want you to pray with me for the church, not just Spirit Lake Church, but for God's church, the church of God throughout the world, His church, those believers who were committed to coming into fellowship before all this broke loose a year ago in March. And here we are in March. I want you to consider something with me. I believe that the devil would love to stretch our adjustment, which is okay, because we had to, right? We didn't know anything about this pandemic. I believe the devil would love to stretch the church's adjustment into an abandonment. I'm just going to say that. I just believe that he would, because he is the father of all lies. He is the deceiver of the brethren. Scripture said he is the one who would like to divide the flock. And I would just say that I think that he would love to, when all the vaccines have been given, and they're giving them out mail in every corner. You just need to go to the vaccines, okay? But they got them everywhere now. You can get a vaccine. When all the vaccines are given, when the last mask is worn, there'll be some people that used to go to church all the time that don't go anymore. So how can you say that, Tom? Well, look now. See, again, I love math. It's a pattern. And so are people. And so are behaviors. We get into the habit of something and we just keep that habit. And until we make ourselves form a new habit, you can never give up a bad habit. I can tell you that. The drug addict never gives it up. You know what they do? They replace it with a good one. Now think about that. Look at yourself. You have never given up a bad habit. You just replace it with a good one. You're sitting in church. You're not some place that you shouldn't be. You're sitting right here in front of me. You didn't give up that bad habit. You replaced it with a good one. You know, you think about that, and it's true about our nature. We got all this time, and we spend it all. We don't waste any time. Unless we're wasting time, if you know what I mean. We all have 24 hours. We get into habits. We get into patterns. And here's why I say that the devil would love, and I want you to pray that his scheme would not be taken a hold to by the church, is I think that he would love to turn a justified adjustment, people need to, into an abandonment. Because right now you see little bitty patterns and traces of that. Again, most people are not ready to come back to church and have a potluck dinner. I don't think we're having one today. I mean, I'd go to it, but I don't think we are. You know, because I've gotten a little longer, and so I might be getting hungry here. But we would. I wouldn't go to it. You know, most people are not ready for that. But if a person is okay to go to shop and go to eat, and yet they say, I don't know if I'm going to church, I would say they're kind of stretching an adjustment into an abandonment. I mean, I'm just saying that. It really is, because there's plenty of room. There's plenty of space. There's plenty of masks. There's plenty of things that we can do. And it doesn't happen overnight. It happens a little bit at a time. If you thought of a time when you fall away from the Lord, you didn't just wake up one morning and say, hey, I'm just going to give God a break. It's slow. See, it's slow. You don't even realize it. You know, the old example of a frog being boiled, you just kind of crank up the heat a little bit and he just never gets out. That's the devil's scheme, see? So pray with me and let's encourage others. Hey, if you need to stay away, stay away. There's no judgment. But you know, if you can, the writer of Hebrews said, let us not forsake the assembling of ourselves together, some in the habit of doing, but more so as you see the day approaching, because we need to encourage each other. And if there's any time in life that the church needed to encourage, I'd say it be now.
Amen.
So let's think of that. Let's consider that. And as we close, I want you to remember, our goal is to be spiritually healthy. And the writer says, if you want to do that, he says, but put a bunch of lettuce in it. Right? I mean, just put a bunch of lettuce in your life. He said, let us draw near to God. Oh, that's a good thing. Let us hold on to hope. Oh, what a great, wonderful piece that is. Let us consider others more than ourselves. Let us meet together. Let us encourage one another, he said. And if you do that, then you'll be spiritually healthy. But more importantly, you will be a source of spiritual nourishment for someone else.
You'll be a healthy spiritual salad that other people are going to enjoy. Man, it's going to be a great thing. In closing, I want to leave you with the words of Jesus because they're so much better than mine. He told Peter, Peter loved him. You know Peter. Cut the ear off of a religious official. Man, don't you know some preachers, you just love to cut their ears off. Not today. Don't answer that. I mean, he just cut the ear off of it. He was fired up for Jesus and denied him, y'all. He loved him. And you know what Jesus said in closing? He said, Peter, if you love me, feed my sheep. You know what? Sheep like this. Let's get a lot in us. Let's go out and feed the world, amen? Let's pray. Father, thank you for your word. God, we just ask that you would speak to us individually. We ask that you would allow us to put these precepts, these principles, these truths into our lives. And God, that we would share them with other people. Father, we thank you for those who are here with us, those who are watching online, those, God, who may see this in a recording. And God, we just pray that your spirit would speak to them and let them know what you would have them to do with this word. Let us never forget, God, that there is no condemnation for those in Christ Jesus. There's no judgment. There's nothing other than the word of God, and it rightly divides. And I just pray that we would all, starting with myself, continue to search our hearts and God, allow you to divide those things out, that we could be a blessing to those around us, that we could be spiritually healthy, and that we could be a source of nourishment for others who are looking for you. For it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Wow. How's your salad today? Mine's been tossed a little bit. How about you? I got some dressing I got to take off because I don't want to people drown. Wow. That's very good, brother. Appreciate that. Wow. There's some tough leaves in there. Caring about other people more than us. That's a tough thing. My wife has this saying, it's not all about you, Ed. I don't know where she got that from. But she keeps saying that. One time she said it so long, I just got tired of it, and I started doing something different. Maybe that's what we need to do. I don't know. Well, we've got a great song to close with today. You know, sometimes I think our salad isn't too good because we forget who God is and what he is capable of. And this song speaks to that. It's called, Whom Shall I Fear? The God of Angel Armies. Listen to the words of it because I love the particular. And nothing formed against me shall stand. You hold the whole world in your hands. I'm holding on to your promises. You're faithful. You're faithful. If we just think we're serving some little piddly God, then I understand why we're afraid, but we don't have to be afraid. Let's all sing.
You hear me when I call. You are my morning star. The darkness fills the night. It cannot hide the light. Who shall I fear? You crush the enemy underneath my feet. You are my sword and shield. The troubles linger still. Who shall I fear? I know who goes before me. I know who stands behind.
Lord, we ask you now to fill your people this week with this sound, Lord. Fill them with all that's left and send them out, Lord, rejoicing and coming back, bringing in the sheaves with all those seeds that are planted. Father, we ask that you would bless these people as they leave. You take care of them all week, but Lord, just fill them with an unquenchable desire to tell others about you and not to find people, or even better yet, just show them how you love them. Don't have to say a word, just show them. Lord, help me. Help me to do it. And Lord, bless your people, we ask in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen. And they said, God loves you, and so do I. He moved on that.
Thank you.
Go have some good weather.